Good morning and welcome to the 7th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies today. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Our next agenda item is an evidence session on the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill. The bill was introduced to the Scottish Parliament on the 31st of October 2023 and is currently at stage one. It amends the Social Security Scotland Act 2018 to make changes to the Scottish social security system. Its general aims are to enhance the Scottish system of social security, including to improve the experience of people using the service provided by Social Security Scotland, deliver increased efficiency and value for money, implement the findings of an independent review into the remit and operation of the Scottish Commission on Social Security, and revoke emergency provision inserted into the 2018 Act in 2020 at the height of the COVID-19 pandemic. Our first evidence session will provide general context and a good overview of all 8 substantive parts of the bill, with a panel of witnesses with expert knowledge of how the social security system works. So I welcome to the meeting John Shaw, welfare rights worker, Child Poverty Action Group, and Erica Young, Policy Officer for Social Justice, Citizens Advice Scotland, and they're joining us in the room. And we have Michael Clancy, OBE, WS, Director of Law Reform, the Law Society of Scotland, Diane Connock, Advice Services and Welfare Reform Team Leader, Stirling Council, and Richard Gass, Welfare Rights and Money Advice Manager, Glasgow City Council, and they are joining us remotely. So thank you very much for accepting our invitation. And just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So if you'd please wait until I or a member asking the question say your name before speaking. And don't feel that you have to answer every single question. If you have nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's perfectly okay as well. For witnesses online, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. And you can indicate with an R in the chat box in Zoom if you wish to come in on a question as well. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? And I hope we'll probably start now with the questions and try and finish for about 10:30 as well. So I'm going to invite Roz first up.
Thank you, convener, and welcome everybody either online and in the room. My questions are on the new forms of benefits. I'm going to start with the online if I can. Ms. Connor, please. This question to you first of all, but I'd like to let it come into the room. The bill would give the Scottish Government more flexibility over rules for the Scottish child payment. And I'm very happy that you're here because you represent a sort of rural environment that we don't often have in the room. So could you give me an idea of what changes should be prioritised from your perspective, please?
Yes, I mean, certainly, we're more than happy with the, you know, with the changes that is being put forward, you know, within the bill at the moment. As you've touched on, I mean, Stirling comprises of an urban and a very rural area as well, and we do know that people within rural areas do tend to have to have a more substantial income to start with, you know, in order not to be in poverty. So certainly, anything that comes in that's going to help that can only be you know, beneficial round about that as well, and anything that's sort of transparent, you know, in order to do that. But I think it very much is taking, you know, taking the services out into the communities as well, and certainly that's through the local delivery team and through local services as well, you know, within that.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Can I ask the same question, please, of Mr. Shaw? Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity. So generally, we think that priority should be given both to increasing the value of Scottish Child Payment and also to fix those specific issues which come from its current legal status as a top-up benefit to other entitlements. So the obvious one of those would be where there is a gap, even a short one, in entitlement to a qualifying benefit. Scottish Child Payment simply cannot continue. And then we have other groups who cannot get a qualifying benefit, even though their income level is in a similar place to people who can. So that might be due to somebody's housing tenure, or perhaps because they're getting maternity allowance rather than statutory maternity pay because of their different treatment within Universal Credit. And then some people from abroad as well who are excluded from reserved benefits. And other than that, we think that there should be priority given to backdating new claims for a Scottish Child Payment, which currently can't happen unless somebody already gets Scottish Child Payment for another child, and addressing the issue of the cliff edge, where a small increase in income can result in a drop in Scottish Child Payment because Universal Credit stops and leaves someone worse off overall. And finally, sorry, my list of demands continues. The issue of qualifying young people as well, because increasingly it's expected that people beyond the age of 16 will remain dependent on their parents in school, but at present, 16 is the cut-off point for the additional support provided by the Scottish Child Payment.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Mr. Shaw. That's, by my reckoning, about seven priorities. But anyway, that's lovely. Thank you. Thank you very much. Happy to. I don't know if there was any sub.
I believe Bob would like to come in on a supplementary. Thanks.
Thanks. I suppose, given Mr. Shaw set out priorities for using that greater flexibility as by the this legislation making the provision for a standalone benefit, if you like. I'll come to Mr. Shaw with the supplementary. And of course, this is not about more money in relation to the Scottish Child Payment. It's about greater flexibilities, which may require more money. Can you say a little bit more about the cliff edge, not just in terms of universal credit, but in terms of better off calculations for people as they may lose universal credit because they increase their hours of work or get into full-time employment? Is that a kind of hard landing for some families, and is there a disincentive for some people to go into work because there's not a taper in relation to continuing to a roll on or a taper in relation to Scottish Child Payment levels as folk get more employment or go into full-time employment?
Yeah, it's certainly something we see. We get asked about this where, you know, the effect of a couple of hours increased work is that just lifts somebody off universal credit entitlement. And right now, Scottish Child Payment isn't the only entitlement that's lost. You also lose access to Best Start Foods at exactly the same income point. You can no longer get a Best Start grant. So as to how that's addressed, one option would be to allow Scottish Child Payment to taper away in a similar way to Universal Credit, but above the point at which Universal Credit stopped, or a run-on would be another option, which might be more administratively simple, but also where there's a sustained increase in income, wouldn't continue to provide support in the longer term. So both of those should be considered as options, and we're happy that the translation of Scottish Child Payment into childhood assistance will give the option to do either of those things, and look forward to seeing concrete improvements made, because the other side of this is that there's no compulsion to do any of those things at the moment. All this does is change the legislative basis, and there's nothing in the bill itself which would force either of these things to happen.
Of course, that's helpful. It's the legislative basis that we're scrutinising rather than the policy positions once that legislative basis has been changed, but that's very helpful, Mr. Shaw.
I believe Diane Connock wants to come in.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I just wanted to come back in and just on one of the points that was raised there. I think definitely one of the priorities has to be separating that out from the DWP benefits like universal credit, because what we are seeing in practice is some people aren't actually applying for the Scottish Child Payment because with universal credit they're going in and out of eligibility. Which greatly impacts that. So I think, you know, in order for people to actually apply for this much needed benefit, it does, I think, need to very much have that standalone nature.
Okay, thanks, Diane. I'm going to bring in Richard Gass. Thanks.
Thank you. Just to continue on the John's point about a run-on, and I think a run-on is an immediate necessity. We have many employees across Scotland who get paid either four-weekly, or they perhaps get extra bonus at Christmas, or they get a pay award that's not settled but paid in a lump sum at a later stage. And often where there's the double payment or the extra payment, that can be sufficient to take somebody out of universal credit for that period. And if they come out of universal credit, then that could prevent them from qualifying for the Scottish Child Payment. So there's an unintended consequence. The person might not necessarily feel any better off, particularly if it's a four-weekly pay cycle they're on, to then also lose their Scottish Child Payment would be a double dunt. And just an unobvious omission is that there's only one means-tested benefit that doesn't have a two-child policy, and that's the council tax reduction, which is under the control of the Scottish Government. So we'd like to think that we would like our own benefit as a qualifying route to entitlement. Thank you.
Thanks, Richard. I'm now going to bring in Jeremy, who wants to come in.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everybody. I wonder if I could maybe start with Erica for this question. Just broadening out slightly, this is an opportunity, if a Parliament wants, to introduce any new benefit around Social Security. And I wonder, from the work that you do, if you had a kind of magic wand and could introduce a new benefit, what would that be, and who would you target it at?
One of our significant concerns at the moment is around the energy costs being faced by those with health conditions. So we would like to see the extension of support for energy costs to working age disabled people. At the moment, it is possible to get that additional support if you have a disabled child within the household, but not if you're a working age disabled adult. So that would be one thing I would prioritise. Following on from what others have said in relation to Scottish Child Payment and introducing that on a different legislative footing, I think what's really the crux of the matter here is developing a needs-based criteria around that new version of Scottish Child Benefit when it's introduced. And we have particular concerns around maternity allowance and the impact of how that's treated as a benefit in terms of universal credit, which means people fall out of both universal credit qualification and also Scottish Child Payment qualification simultaneously. We would also be seeking an alignment of Scottish Child Payment with Best Start Foods to facilitate those who have no recourse to public funds to access the support. At the moment, it's quite clearly done for Best Start Foods, but that's the only benefit delivered within Scotland that currently enables you to access it if you have no recourse to public funds.
Thank you. Can I open it up to others, whether there's other anyone else wants to answer the question around if we could introduce a new benefit, what it would be?
I think specifically in relation to Scottish Child Payment, I'm not sure if this will quite be a new benefit, but right now we can only have one person responsible for a child. So I think that something that should be looked at is the situation where you have equally shared care between two separated parents, and particularly if universal credit continues to be the trump card for deciding responsibility for a child, the universal credit rules seem to actually prevent the Scottish Government from paying Scottish Child Payment for one child to one parent and the other child to the other parent, which seems like a perfectly logical approach.
Okay, thank you very much. Could I just remind the witnesses that are here in person that you don't have to work your console, it'll come on automatically when we invite you in. Thank you very much. I believe Michael Clancy would like to come in.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I just draw attention to something that John Shaw said about the upper limit for child payment being 16? As members and everyone in the room will be aware, the UNCRC Act ensures that the age of a child is 18 in Scotland. And I think that I would like to draw attention to Article 26 of the Convention, which states that states parties shall recognise for every child the right to benefit from social security. So you can see where I'm going with this. If the upper limit at the moment is 16, yet the convention, which is going to be in force in the very near future, has a definition of child as being a person under the age of 18, there's a gap there. And it might be something that the Scottish Government already have a plan for, or one of the panel might be able to inform me that, don't worry, Michael, this is all taken care of. But I think it's something that we should at least acknowledge in all of this discussion.
Okay, thanks, Michael. That is helpful. Yep, that's noted. Thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Ross in. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. My second question is on the proposed care leavers payment. This is something that's a bit of a passion of mine. I'm slightly concerned that we're maybe looking at this from an angle where we don't have a lot of the detail behind this yet. We're still not 100% sure what the definition of a care leaver is. We're still not 100% sure what process this is going to take, whether it's £2,000 up front, whether it's going to be a split payment. There's a whole raft of information that maybe we don't have behind this question, but I'm going to ask the question anyway because it's on social security side of things. But the CPAG suggests that the care leavers payment should be delivered by Social Security Scotland unless there's a very good reason to use a different agency. So why is that, and why would delivery by Social Security Scotland be your first choice, if it is your first choice? And Erica, can I start with yourself, please, and then to John. Thank you.
Thank you. On the last point, I think the key here is consistency and predictability for those accessing the right to Social Security. Everything being within the one agency, I think, is fairly critical here, given that we already have a number of agencies operating in this space, namely local authorities for example, council tax reduction, the Department of Work and Pensions for reserve benefits. To then ask someone to engage with a fourth agency, potentially, and they may also be involved with other support services as well, I think would be quite overwhelming. So for the sake of consistency and also the learned agency experience that's been built up with Social Security Scotland, I think also makes them an appropriate agency to deliver the new benefit.
Thank you. Thank you, John.
Absolutely agree with all the points that Eric has made there. I think the reason we think Social Security Scotland feels like the logical first choice is clues in the name, I guess. And in terms of if you can have a single body delivering the new payment across Scotland, the principle is that delivery of Social Security is a public service on the face of the Act. Yeah. So I think we'd possibly go further and say that we think it should be assistance within Part 2 of the Act, because what that does is it gives consistency, as Erica said, with mechanisms of challenge. I know the policy memorandum cites Best Start Foods as a reason that payments delivered by Social Security Scotland don't have to be within Part 2 of the Act, but that does have an issue. There is no right to appeal to an independent tribunal if you're refused Best Start Foods, because it doesn't come within the framework of the Act, and the same applies to the JobStart payment. And I suppose the other logical option might be delivery by local authorities, but as Erica touched upon, I think there is an advantage to central delivery where there is a single set of straightforward eligibility criteria which are the same across Scotland, simply because local authorities, by the sound of the consultation proposals, are not going to have any discretion about who they award it to and how much they award. And also there's the question of children who've been looked after in England. Which local authority would be administering a claim made by a child who wasn't actually looked after by that Scottish local authority?
Thank you very much. That's very informative. Convener, based on the answers, which I accept wholeheartedly, and the evidence that we're bringing, but equally I do think we should know a little bit more about what it is we're actually trying to do, considering the consultation is now over. So is it possible to ask if we could write maybe to the Cabinet Secretary on a little bit of background information, which I know is not pertinent necessarily to this evidence session, but I think it would be nice for the committee to know. Thank you.
Yep, I'm happy to do that as well, right to the Cabinet Secretary in relation to that, Ros, and the clerks will note that in the report as well. So thank you. I'm now going to move on to theme two, which is applications for assistance, and I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. I understand part two of the bill is to do with late applications. In fact, it's just going to remove some options. But I'm interested to know what witnesses today think, if there should be, if it's okay to leave the other applications as they are with the rules, or if people feel that they need to be relaxed more or tightened up more. So maybe if I could start with Mr. Gass, and then I was going to come to Mr. Clancy.
Thank you. The intended rules for appeals and for redeterminations, that's welcome. But you're right, there's a gap when it comes to claims for benefit. For claims for benefit under COVID, it was recognised that there was an exceptional circumstance. So let's allow, in those circumstances, a backdated claim. The fact that not many folk took up that option should not be a reason not to have a provision going forward. In fact, if not too many folk take up the option, then there's a kind of financial security that it's not going to burn an expenditure that's unpredictable. But there are circumstances, somebody who's perhaps involved in a car crash, in a coma, or someone with severe mental health problems, why should, as a consequence of their inability to make a claim, mean that they lose out on entitlement? So not saying make it an open door, but look for exceptional circumstances, and where these can be evidenced, then it would only seem proper that payments could be backdated.
I mean, can I just press you on that as to what is the logic for backdated payments? Because if it's something like, say, a funeral payment, well, that was a one-off payment, and you can see why it needs to be backdated. But if it's food or heating or something, in a sense, you know, that's already gone. They've already gone with a cold house or lack of food. So what is the logic of a back payment in such circumstances?
Well, they may have gone with a cold house, or they may have gone with a house that was heated and the bill's not yet been received, so the costs could still be there. Someone who is perhaps in hospital with mental health or with a physical disability, yes, they're maybe not living in their house, but their ongoing costs outside the hospital wards do still continue.
OK, thank you. Mr. Glancy, from a legal point of view, should people always be entitled to late payments, and should there be a limit as to how far back people can go?
I would hesitate to say that my view would be a legal point of view, Mr. Mason, but I'll try my best. There is always, I think, an interest in having latitude, because sometimes the hard cases make bad law. We all know that maxim. Our view on the issues which you raised generally was that laws which make the situation for people who are in a vulnerable position more complex or less accessible are not really good laws, and that we should be wary about introducing additional complexity. And I think that comes out in terms of the time limits for appeal, and the way in which the 31 days can be extended to a year, essentially. But it's also this difference between having a good reason for delay in making the application and transforming it when it comes to the appeal stage to being exceptional circumstances. And sometimes the difference between a good reason and exceptional circumstances might be difficult to get a grasp of. I know that I struggled a little with it myself when looking at the bill, but that's what our our committee has been thinking about is that, that we should make things as easy as possible for applicants and make sure that, the routes to redetermination and appeal are clear, and that we shouldn't introduce unnecessary complications to the system.
Okay, thanks. I mean, Ms Young, if we just throw in good reason and exceptional circumstances kind of all over the place, does that kind of cover all eventualities, or does it just make it all very vague?
I think what is important here is that there is a structure in terms of the guide. At the moment, for example, with adult disability payment, which is an extremely complex benefit, can be very daunting. It can be psychologically exhausting to go through that application process. Advice can be essential in many circumstances, but it can take time to organise. It can even take time for a client to psychologically prepare to ask for the help. So we therefore think there does need to be a consistency in the benefit journey in terms of complex benefits like adult disability and child disability benefits. So if we're going to introduce good reason and exceptional circumstances in respect of redeterminations and appeals, I think it's vital that we also introduce that for completing the initial application and also for submitting review forms. At the moment, if a review form, you only have 28 days to do it, regardless of whether it's scheduled by Social Security Scotland or triggered by a change in circumstances. So to alleviate distress, we do think these two concepts need to be there across the benefit journey, but that there also needs to be some structural guidance around them to understand some of the complex differences that we've just been hearing about from a legal perspective. There'll also be some differences in the way the Tribunal might view it as opposed to the way Social Security Scotland might view it for redeterminations, because they're independent entities. So guidance that helps both bodies apply this consistently will be important. At the moment, for example, if you apply for adult disability payment and you do submit it late, there is a possibility to use good reason. Again, that's not elaborated on or defined in either decision makers' guidance or within the legislation itself. So we do need to have a think about that. And what is at stake here is the finances of the claimant, because if an application has to be done afresh or if it has to be treated as made from a later date than it otherwise would, that has a financial implication for the claimant, but it also has a financial implication for their network around them. For example, someone waiting for the outcome of an adult disability payment in order to access carers allowance will also be waiting for additional finance when they may have just given up work to care for that person. So there's a lot of complexities in here that I think indicate the need for a consistent approach.
Okay. Mr. Shaw, did you want to come in?
Yeah, if I could. So I'll try to explain this simply and quickly. Late applications to me looks at two things. So I think the other witnesses have made some excellent points about what happens if it takes you some time after initial contact to complete your application, and there is existing flexibility. So the other kind of late application is entitlement beginning before you contact Social Security Scotland. So carer support payment is an excellent example. All you need to do is apply for carer support payment and say, I met the conditions up to 13 weeks before the date of my application being started, and Social Security Scotland can award the payment if you met the conditions. No need for good reason. That's a policy choice to allow what we would call backdating of up to 3 months. So Scottish Child Payment is another example where the qualifying benefit can be backdated, but at present there is no provision in the rules for an application for Scottish Child Payment to be treated as made before the date it's submitted to Social Security Scotland. And I think Richard Gass made some excellent points about the fact that, you know, you might still be accruing bills which you're unable to pay. You might have borrowed money in order to manage your circumstances until your universal credit is sorted out.
So would you argue that it should be 13 weeks for everything with no reason necessary, or, as Ms Young suggested, some are more complicated than others, so therefore there should be more flexibility?
Yeah, I think case by case. I think we being who we are, would obviously argue Scottish Child Payment should be a priority. One slight mitigating factor for the disability benefits is you have the 13-week qualifying period, because you're never going to get paid until you've had those needs for 13 weeks unless you're terminally ill. So that provides some mitigation in relation to the disability benefits. But the approach taken by a lot of the reserve benefits was a kind of halfway house where there was provision for a claim to be treated as made earlier than the date of first contact with good reason. Now, none of the current Scottish benefits do that, and we think it's more administratively simple if the only decision Social Security Scotland have to make is that somebody met the entitlement conditions rather than also going into why it was that they weren't able to get in contact sooner, because that simply creates more of a burden for the decision maker. So I think certainly if you look at carer support payment, the decision's been taken that there will be backdating of carer support payments to before those regulations were introduced, simply because it can take so long for somebody's disability benefit to be awarded. So I think certainly we need to look again at all of the Scottish benefits, and most of the other ones are one-off payments, which again, if you have an application window, should you be able to apply outside that window if you would have met the conditions had you applied in time? The take-up strategy is absolutely a laudable aim, but it's never going to have 100% success. And to me, the other side of that coin is, if we acknowledge that it's not going to be 100% take-up on the first day entitlement could have started, then a way of mitigating the impossibility of reaching everybody in all circumstances is to allow decision makers to look at whether someone would have been entitled to this payment had they been in touch sooner.
Okay, I'm conscious of time, if that's convenient.
Okay, thank you very much. And I believe, Jeremy, did you want to come in on a supplementary?
I'm happy to do, thank you, convener. Yeah, just around the issue on regard to first tier tribunals, my understanding, obviously, during COVID, they went either online or on telephone. I was approached by a number of people who say they're still happening on telephone, and I'm just wondering, from your experience, whether that's the best way to do it, or whether we should go back to being face-to-face as we were pre-COVID. Erica, it looks like you want to jump in.
Thank you, Jeremy. Yes, this is a significant issue that the network is experiencing. There is supposed to be an approach by which, if there is a good reason for requesting a face-to-face hearing, that should be accommodated. But the experience of our network is that that is not being accommodated, and telephone hearings are the default position. Now, that's problematic for a number of reasons. Most importantly, consultations as a last resort is an incredibly laudable aim. It's impossible to overstate the progress that has been made in relation to that. But what that does mean is that by the time it reaches the appeal stage, face-to-face contact with the person has not actually happened at any stage of that claim. And that person may be desperate to actually speak to someone to demonstrate their circumstances and to actually present their circumstances in the most powerful way. And it's also an important part of the function of the tribunal to be able to tease out that evidence. And it's often cogent oral evidence that really makes the difference in terms of a tribunal's decision. It's also the case that people with certain mental health conditions or neurodivergence will find it very difficult to communicate by the telephone and to fully express their circumstances. So, yeah, I think face-to-face is a vital part of the tribunal service. And at the moment, there seems to have been a very significant shift away from it.
Richard, I don't know if you have experience from Glasgow as well.
Yes, we would favour face-to-face appeals where that is the appellant's choice, and we've tried to exercise our right to have a face-to-face appeal. The appeal letter itself doesn't give the option to tick, do you want a face-to-face appeal? And we have queried why we're being refused face-to-face appeals, and we've been advised that it will only be in exceptional circumstances. Now, the disadvantage to that is that speaking to somebody over the telephone, they could tell you that they're able to do something, but the tribunal are then denied the opportunity to see with their own eyes the difficulty with which someone maybe entered the room, how they rose from their seat to leave the room, how they conducted themselves during the hearing. Simply relying on the person's verbal expression really misses too much of the evidence available. And I'll stop there. I was going to say something else, but I'll stop there. That's fine. Thanks.
I think just for the record, the Commune, I should point out that I was previously a member of the first tier tribunals. Just for the record for that. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Jeremy, for making us aware of that. Now we're going to move on to theme three, which is challenging decisions, and I'm going to invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. It's great to see you all this morning. Thanks for your time. The Bill makes changes to provisions for late requests, for redeterminations and appeals. And will these changes improve the client experience, and what other changes to redetermination and appeals timescales are needed? I'll go to Erica first, if that's okay.
Sure. Absolutely, yes. We do anticipate that this will improve the claimant experience quite dramatically. You know, our advisors see people for whom picking up the phone to ask for help can take over 2 weeks of psychological preparation. Others who are consumed by, for example, ongoing intensive treatment or court processes involving abusive former partners. These kinds of circumstances are not currently that well accommodated by the existing system, so we think that these changes will improve that. We would support robust guidance, though, co-designed to ensure, you know, the effective implementation of these changes, you know, even under the existing provisions. What we're seeing is quite wide-ranging reports of inaccurate information being given by call handling staff, informing people that the six-week time frame to request a redetermination is an absolute limit. And that, of course, can cause dropout. People assume that information to be correct and they decide that they can't face any further challenges. But in summary, yes, we do think that there will be significant improvements happen as a result of these changes.
Thanks for that. Anyone else want to come in before I move on to the next question?
Okay. Just in relation to the second part, the background paper helpfully sets out the different timescales. Coming back to Erica's point on, you know, people understanding and simplicity and consistency, we think that the deadline to request a redetermination without needing good reason should be equalised across the different benefits and also extended. Because, come back to my previous point, people struggle to provide that good reason and articulate it. And just on the timescales for Social Security Scotland to carry out a redetermination, even if there is a justification for different timescales depending on the complexity of the benefit, the justification for sometimes using working days and sometimes using calendar days, it just feels like a needless complexity. I think there's also an argument for aligning appeal deadlines, but that would require changes to the primary legislation as well.
Thank you for that.
I believe Richard Gass would like to come in. Thanks.
Thank you. I would agree that the proposed changes will make things better. However, I think that a bigger change that would make things even better would be to do away with mandatory reconsiderations. It's just adding an extra hurdle to go through. We know that the changes are going to allow, when an appeal's been lodged for Social Security Scotland, to make another decision. So why have the mandatory reconsideration? Somebody should simply be able to say, you've made your decision, I'm not happy with that, I'd like to pursue that further. And the ultimate pursuit of that would be to a tribunal. And if the opportunity arises to improve the benefits, the satisfaction prior to getting there, great, but unnecessary for a mandatory reconsideration.
Thank you. I'll stay with you, Mr Gass. What measures are needed to ensure individuals are not pressurised into either lapsing appeals or withdrawing redetermination requests? And obviously, you raised in your written submission, and we know from 22-23 that 22% of PIP appeals were lapsed. Can you give us some insight into this kind of current practice by the DWP and any lessons for the Scottish benefits?
Well, with the DWP system, what's happening is when somebody has their mandatory reconsideration, get my terminology right there, they may have uttered the words, I want to appeal the decision, but the next step is the mandatory reconsideration. They then get awarded something at that. They feel they've had a bite at the cherry, and therefore to go to a tribunal after that, they may feel that there's no point, I'm not going to get anything more. So we're concerned that when folk are offered a wee bit more, they then accept that, thinking, well, that's the best it's going to be. And at a tribunal, that they're then reaching for something that is out of reach, whereby it should be a case of it can progress to a tribunal because you've not been awarded everything you've asked for, but the option is for you to now withdraw your appeal, not to be in a situation where you have to then initiate the next step. Hope that makes sense.
No, it does. Thank you very much.
Sorry, I believe Michael would like to come in, and then Diane. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. It's a very interesting question to pose, and I'm thinking of the one about mandatory redetermination stages. Now, some, of course, and we've heard the argument this morning, oppose mandatory redetermination because it places an obstacle in the way of appeal rights. And we think that, that having an immediate right of appeal would not preclude Social Security Scotland from undertaking a redetermination review to ensure that a decision is correct and can be defended before an appeal. That would be one distinct possibility. But even if we look across to what happens at UK level, mandatory reconsideration accounts for about 70% of UK DLA and PIP appeals, which are still successful. So we suggest that it's not necessarily getting to the correct position here, and that we've got to think carefully about this. And on the question of lapsed appeals, I think one of the ways in which we are suggesting that, lapsed appeals could be properly evidenced is, of course, to have the individuals concerned confirm in writing that they are content for their appeal to be lapsed and their redetermination request to be withdrawn. I think we've got to have informed consent to these exercises. And it's something which is quite important, particularly when we think in terms of the social security principles and respecting the dignity of the individuals concerned.
Thank you for that.
I'm going to bring Diane in. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to come in on a couple of the points. The first one about the mandatory reconsideration sort of process within that. I think that to go straight to an appeal would potentially put a lot of our vulnerable clients off of the appeals process, because I think the whole prospect of having to go to an appeal can sometimes be too much for people, and I would be worried then that people weren't potentially challenging a decision within that as well. There's also, with the mandatory reconsiderations being dealt with that bit quicker as well, the payments potentially should come through that bit quicker than waiting for payments to be made and backdated after the, you know, after the appeal's been heard. I think really as well, it is more cost effective as well, you know, for it to be done through the mandatory reconsideration process within that. So I think certainly we would be in favour of there being a process, whether it is that Social Security Scotland can go back and do that as part of the appeal process, and there's not that sort of stage as such, but I would be worried about it, you know, disappearing completely. The other thing with regard to withdrawing a mandatory reconsideration or an appeal, I think that it does all come down to claimant choice, but I think that the claimants, if they're looking to withdraw, should be asked if they've sought advice at all, and they should be encouraged to do so, because it may well be that they lodge an appeal, lodge a mandatory reconsideration, and then they maybe get advice from an advice service and find out that really they have got the benefits that they feel they're eligible for, and then they might want to withdraw that, or likewise they might decide then that they want to put a mandatory reconsideration in at that stage. So I think there definitely needs to be that. The same with when they're withdrawn as well. I like the idea of a cooling off period for that to be reinstated. Because again, I would be concerned that somebody withdrew their application and then they maybe sought advice after that and found out that, yes, they do have grounds for appealing that. So I think there definitely needs to be that.
Diane,
that
sorry,
choice.
Can I just stop you there? Because I believe there's further down in the session we've got that line of questioning. I'll stop you there and I'll bring Marie back in. Thank you.
OK, thanks. Can obviously CPAG suggested that redetermination requests that have been withdrawn should be able to be reinstated if the client changes their mind, obviously just discussed. And how would that work in practice? Maybe bring Diane back in a wee second.
So, yeah, I think a good model for that is the ability to reinstate a withdrawn appeal, which Diane mentioned. The issue here is that there's no secondary legislation around redetermination, so it has to come in via an amendment to the Act. We would argue that it should simply be enough for someone to change their mind. The issue is that if you have to make a further redetermination, it might be late. That places a burden on the applicant to justify lateness and explain why they've changed their mind, and a decision-making burden on Social Security Scotland. So we would say a simple amendment to say that somebody who has withdrawn a request has a fixed time period to reinstate that request and doesn't need to give any reasons for doing so.
Thanks for that. Diane, do you want to come back in again? Just maybe expand on that. Have you got anything else to say?
Yes, thank you. Not really, no. I mean, I think John's just covered that there. I think it really, there does have to be something written in that people are able to withdraw, but I think there does need to be that time period then given to people. And it has to be a reasonable time period as well, because it might well be that people want to seek advice, which can take a bit of time as well within that.
And in general, I'm also interested in how the first-tier tribunals are operating in relation to the Scottish benefits. And while we have you here, is there any concerns you kind of want to highlight to us? Anything you want?
Not at this stage. I think it's too early, really, within the process to be highlighting a lot of that, because really with the time it's taken for things like adult disability payments to be processed, we are just starting to see, you know, a lot of those challenges coming in at the moment. So I think that might be something that we can answer at a later stage. But again, just to say that there have been a couple of occasions where we've ticked the box as well for face-to-face, and that's not been offered. So I think there just needs to be a wee bit more around that. But I think that it's timescales as well, because I know if there's two, you know, it's quicker to do that, the tribunals over the phone, and there can be a sort of quicker appointment than potentially waiting for that face-to-face. But there are situations where face-to-face is preferable for the clients.
Thanks for that.
Okay, I believe Richard Gass would like to come in. Thank you.
Hello. I saw in the Spice paper that one of the suggested questions was about, were there any current practices that we could recommend a change that wouldn't necessarily require legislation? I think your question there kind of pointed towards that. And if not, then I'll hold my fire and come back. But if that was part of the question, then I've got something I'd like to say.
Richard, I'll stop you there, and I'm going to invite Paul O'Kane in, who I believe will draw up on that question.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. What we'll maybe do is, there's a specific question around one of Citizens Advice asks in this space, and then we'll maybe come back into the generic issue, if that's all right. So obviously the bill doesn't change the requirement to have redetermination before an appeal, but Citizens Advice have said quite clearly that they want to see that change. So I wonder if I can just ask you to explain a bit more about that ask and the advantages and disadvantages you would see in that space.
Absolutely. Thank you. We believe that the focus of all of these reforms should be on breaking down barriers to realising the right to Social Security. Simpler, more accessible mechanisms, they just improve accountability and they engender trust. Being refused adult disability payment, for example, it triggers very complex responses and mixed emotions. It's a difficult thing. A system which delivers on dignity, fairness and respect should not expect people to wait a minimum of 2 months for Social Security Scotland to in effect mark its own homework and to then have to go through a further administrative process to raise an appeal. The entire journey process from applying for adult disability payment to having an appeal heard can take over a year, and we just don't think that can be acceptable. Our advisers can struggle to support people to remember what their circumstances were at the date of the claim because so much time has passed. Again, we don't think that can be acceptable. So a simpler process that allows a client to simply submit an appeal, at which point the appeal lapsing process can be used to reduce unnecessary hearings. And we believe that will offset any additional pressure that it might be placed on the tribunal service. And we also think the emphasis on the appeal being lodged to an independent body, but without necessarily an appeal hearing always going to go ahead will alleviate some of the anxiety that's been highlighted before that some clients might have about going to an appeal. It's not necessarily going to happen. I would also highlight that actually the data is suggesting that the success rate, well, as in awards in favour of the person, is about 52% for redeterminations and about 54% for appeals. So it's roughly equivalent. So we think it's just an additional process, in effect. I think it's always important to bear in mind as well that pressure is frequently also felt by the friends and family members upon which the person's become increasingly reliant for support. It's impossible to overstate just how significant these awards are in terms of helping people manage their day-to-day lives to access the kind of support that's essential for them. And we know that a lot of this is diverted into the really fundamentals, such as nutrition and energy costs. People cannot afford to wait these lengths of time, and the mandatory reconsideration process is simply an additional step. You know, our networks, sorry to go on here, but our networks, you know, currently having to advise people going through, for example, bowel cancer treatment, going through complex court processes in relation to domestic abuse, at the same time being told when they present with an unsuccessful redetermination, we're really sorry, but what we have to advise you is that the next step is to raise an appeal. It's exhausting and overwhelming for people. Thank you.
Okay. I think John might want to comment, if that's possible, convener.
Yep, no.
Yeah, absolutely. And what's been described here is very similar to the pre-2013 DWP appeal process. You only have to make one challenge. And if the decision is changed, it can only increase your award. So that's similar to the protection which we're looking at introducing here. And I think we haven't really seen a lot in the redetermination process, which we opposed during the passage of the Social Security Scotland Act, to show that it's meaningfully different from mandatory reconsiderations at the UK level. The advantage of a direct appeal is simply that it never has to get to the tribunal service. If somebody identifies a more favourable decision to the person, then they can make it, and the tribunal service never has to even be involved. And for that reason, that's why we argue that we don't think consent should be required to lapse an appeal, because that simply adds a bit more confusion and debate. And I realise I'm not saying the same as the other witnesses here, but because there is that protection that it must be more favourable, it makes it more administratively simple. And it would fit well with removing redeterminations entirely, because one of the things that we are worried might become a chilling effect on people challenging decisions is that redeterminations can make the award go down as well as up. So if someone thinks they haven't been awarded enough but have been awarded some benefit, then obviously that becomes a barrier to challenging that decision. Whereas if you go straight to an appeal and the decision maker can only lapse that appeal if they make you a more favourable award, then that will remove that disincentive to challenge. And as Erica says, the justification for two steps is difficult to see.
I don't have any further comments just on that point before we move on to the subsequent point.
There's
no indication?
No.
Okay, I'm thank you for that. I think that's helpful in terms of our consideration. The bill would also clarify the actions a tribunal and ministers can take in a process appeal. And I think committee is keen to understand the advantages and disadvantages of having different procedures for challenging process decisions compared to other kinds of decisions. So I don't know if you know, Richard or Diane might have a view on that.
Richard wants to come in, sorry.
I think that process appeals and ones determining the facts should be the same process. I don't see a justification for them being different. Sorry, that's maybe not a very well stated answer, but that's my answer.
Thank you. Would anyone else want to comment? I think John could be that.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with Richard. I think it's worth saying we may come back onto this with the overpayment liabilities, but that's going to be a separate challenge process. We're going to have reviews of appointeeships, which looks like it might be a further different challenge process. There's an obvious advantage to a simple and straightforward and unified process to get from not liking what has happened to an appeal tribunal. The only advantage of the current appeal process that I can see is that otherwise there would simply be no challenge to the failure to accept an application or a redetermination request. So it is better than nothing, and certainly it felt like it was introduced as a kind of way of ensuring that there was some oversight and ability to get to an independent challenge. But we would certainly agree that unifying all of those processes would be a positive step.
Okay.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Jeremy in. Thank you.
I've no questions, Ms. Kavina.
No. Okay. We're moving on to theme four in terms of overpayments. And I'm now going to invite Bob Dorison. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. So this section is about overpayments, what the liability sits for those overpayments, and it'll bring in liability potential and client representatives as well for the first time. So the intention of the provisional liability is that the person who benefits from the overpayment is liable for that, irrespective of whether that's the representative or whether it's the individual who's got the right to underlying claim in the first place. Has the government got that balance right in how this is framed, or are there alternatives that some might want to suggest, and I'm not sure who would want to come in on that? Only because Eric is kind of twitching her head. Is that an indication?
I'm happy to kick off the discussion on this one. We're broadly supportive of the policy intent here, which is obviously to make sure that the beneficiary of an overpayment should be the person potentially liable to repay it where it's lawfully recoverable. Our difficulty with it is, however, the seeming conflation of different types of advice and third-party representation. So advice workers and agencies who take instructions and apply the regulations rather than managing a client's affairs or acting as a conduit in the manner of an advocacy worker, they might be deterred from acting. You know, these are different types of third-party involvement. Where third-party involvement is from a person with a financial stake, any overpaid funds are likely to go into a sort of household pot, and so it may be very difficult to delineate exactly who's had the benefit of any overpayment. So effectively, that's our fundamental concern. In some instances, there might be more than one type of advice work involved. So there might be a formal advice agency, a welfare rights worker, but there might also be a friend or family member who's perhaps filled in the initial application and it's then gone to an advice agency for a redetermination. There might also have been advocacy involved at some stage along the lines of the process. So how do we, at the moment, the provisions don't seem to make any distinction between the different forms of third-party involvement that a claim may have had at different points and different stages in the process.
So just before I bring others in, Ms. Young, you're saying that the general principle is correct, but there has to be clarity between what we mean about where the liability sits, where that may be the advice sector offering advice and then acting on the instructions of clients, irrespective of whether they follow the advice offered or not, and whether there's a direct financial benefit to the individual or organisation after that overpayment. That all has to be clear. So the underlying principle is okay, but that has to be set out more clearly and clarified. I don't want to put words into your mouth, but we're obviously looking at how this legislation has to be beefed up or made more clear. Is that what you're saying?
That's precisely what I'm saying. Yes, exactly. It is that clarity. The overall policy intent is not something we oppose. It is about that clarity between the different types of third-party involvement.
Is there a general consensus amongst witnesses that that's the case, or do others want to come in and say something contrary to that or to add to it?
Maybe just a slight... we don't quite see that we can see how it's going to be implemented. It's going to be really difficult to work out who's benefited. You know, there may be situations in which both people have benefited. What's the proportion here? In terms of alternative suggestions, I suppose it's worth remembering that there are more situations in which devolved social security assistance can be recovered than there are for the benefits replaced, like DLA and PIP. If you had more restricted situations in which someone was liable, for example, if it was only because there was a failure to disclose or a misrepresentation of something that Social Security Scotland could take the money back, then it would be much easier to decide who it was who failed to disclose or who misrepresented, and that would be your starting point for who the money was recoverable from. So I think potentially if we're looking for more clarity about liability and who should be responsible for meeting that, if we got back to the previous DLA and PIP system of unless there is a specific failure by somebody, the overpayment is not recoverable, then that would certainly make it easier to identify who that person should be.
Okay. I can see nodding heads in the room anyway. I'm not sure no one online wants to come in on that.
Should lights come in? Thank you.
Yeah. I think I heard in your question, Mr. Doris, that the role of advice agencies, and I just want to make clear that we would not support the idea that advice agencies would be covered by a representative in this situation. Advice agencies enable folk to make claims for benefit. We take at face value what people tell us, and it should never be the case that a representative from the advice sector is held to account for that, unless there were some real charlatan and it was fraudulent, but let's assume that's not the case. At the end of the day, we help folk fill in a form and they then sign the form to say that they're happy with what's on that form. So just to clarify that advice agencies are not representatives in this definition. And my second point is that there is a confusion and complication, and it's already been alluded to that the appointee, the money might go to the household. It could be further complicated if the appointee is managing a DWP benefit for, say, pension credit, and also the Scottish Government, adult disability payment at the moment, but the older person payment in the months to come. If there's then been some misspending of money, how do you then determine which money was spent and who benefited from the Scottish benefit and not the UK benefit?
Okay, I think it's helpful to take some real-life examples of how this is going to have to be applied in practice, so I appreciate that. Can we move on to this?
Yeah, moving on. Thanks.
I feel that we're turning the clock back slightly because we talk about redeterminations and appeals, but in particular, I suppose this would be for John Shaw, because this was raised in evidence by Child Poverty Action Group. So the bill will allow for a review of a decision over overpayment liability, but I think that Mr. Shaw's position is that, or Child Poverty Action Group's position is that the legislation talks about a review. Mr. Shaw, I think you're going to talk about a redetermination. Is it just different words for the same thing?
Well, no, it's not, because it's different processes. And, you know, it's what I'm going to describe as a copy and paste job. If you look at the new sections which have been put in, they are very clearly identical to the redetermination and appeal provisions in relation to a determination of entitlement. And I think what we risk here is replicating the confusion in reserved benefits, where you have to challenge the decision that you've been overpaid and the decision that the overpayment is recoverable separately. Now, in the reserve system, because there's a unified tribunal system, which we don't know if that's the Scottish Government's intention here, you can end up at an appeal which could deal with both decisions, but you have to have challenged both of them for the tribunal to be able to have that jurisdiction. So I suppose what we were expecting the policy solution might be when we were arguing that there should be a right to challenge liability is that it would be added, for example, as a decision under Section 50. So as part of your determination of entitlement, you would get, is there a liability? Who is liable to repay that liability? And that would then create the possibility to use the redetermination and appeals process that already exists elsewhere in the Act to get to a single hearing, which would then look at, was the person overpaid? And if you've decided that there's no overpayment, you then don't need to get into the question, is there a liability to repay that overpayment at all?
Okay. Again, just for my clarity, that's very helpful for myself, so I now realise there's a very clear difference between reviews in redeterminations, and that's something I wasn't aware of, so thank you, Mr. Shaw. Is it unclear about whether, if there's a review, that that will still progress to an appeal if that review is not successful for the individual? Is that one of the more substantive issues in relation to why redeterminations and reviews are different? Just so the committee can be clear. I'm sorry if it's just I haven't understood correctly, Mr. Shaw, but I just want to tease out the importance of a redetermination as opposed to a review.
No, sorry, I think my answer possibly wasn't clear too. So the review provisions mirror the redetermination provisions, and then there is provision to appeal against a review, which mirrors the appeal provisions against a determination of entitlement that has been placed in a separate section of the Act. So essentially, a legal process which is identically worded to the existing provisions has been created by this piece of legislation to sit alongside. So what we're not really getting, having looked at the policy memorandum, it suggested that the options were do nothing or create this new process, but there was nothing about the possibility of ensuring that the existing redetermination and appeal process could be utilised in relation to liability. So there is 100% a right of appeal. It's worded identically to the existing right of appeal, but it sits in a different place within the legislation.
Okay, I think I'll be looking back over the official report and digesting that and see what the government obviously says in response to whom she's listening in response to that as well. But I'll move on. Ms Young, I think it was your organisation that spoke about suggesting there should be an income threshold in place in terms of where debt is sought to be recovered. I know there's provisions within the legislation about the Social Security should be looking at the financial circumstances of each and any individual where there has been an overpayment, liability has been determined, any appeals process has been exhausted, and it's clear that there's been that overpayment. Why do you think there should be that income threshold?
Well, we feel that this would be the fairest, most sustainable, most efficient way of recovering lawfully due overpayments. Reason we argue that is that at the moment there is no structure either in legislation nor guidance as to what constitutes hardship. So although not knowingly place someone into hardship, that's a very vague concept that isn't actually defined. So although, for example, with the adult disability payment regulations, for instance, deductions to be taken at a reasonable level having regard to the circumstances of the individual. Now, that's not further defined. There's no guidance on it. So there's no, for example, guidance threshold on what the percentage deduction from someone's ongoing benefit would be. To give you an illustrative example of the kind of problems that this causes on the ground, so we had a person who had recently been released from prison, had been on remand for 5 months. Accrued an overpayment during that time due to practical difficulties in reporting changes in circumstances, etc. The suggested rate of recovery that the Social Security Agency suggested was £195 a month. Now, the debt was only £670, and given the circumstances of this gentleman just come out of prison, dependent upon universal credit, already subject to deductions from his universal credit for an advance payment from rent arrears and council tax arrears that also accrued during his time on remand, £195 is an entirely unfeasible level. And those kinds of things are happening, those kinds of suggestions are being made because there isn't a structure. And we think an income threshold working much in the same way as student loans, for example, are recovered, would be a much fairer basis and a more sustainable basis for recovery of lawfully due overpayments.
It's always helpful to get a real-life example, because it makes it real rather than just dusty legislation, if you like. Can I check, was that under Social Security Scotland that repayment figure was...
That's correct, yes. It was an adult disability payment, an adult disability payment overpayment.
So
that
I can appreciate concerns. Now, I think Michelle was saying that there's no real fleshed out criteria by which that ability to pay or what a reasonable rate would look like is determined. One option could, of course, be some decent guidance in relation to this rather than an income threshold. I suspect Michelle will still want the income threshold, but the reason I'm asking for that is because income thresholds could change over time.
Yes.
Also, so it's whether that would be on the face of the bill or whether it would be for the bill to take the power to set an income threshold at a later date on the basis that secondary legislation could then amend that income threshold as appropriate. I'm just conscious that income thresholds are also a bit of an arbitrary figure as well. There's other things happening in an individual's life that has to be taken into account. So it's whether you're wed to that income threshold, whether that should be on the face of the bill, and whether more meaningful guidance might be a way around this to be more meaningful also.
Yes, I think guidance would certainly be helpful. In terms of the minimum income threshold, I think what we would be seeking is the development of a mechanism for setting that as opposed to it being prescriptive. Okay. It would be the mechanism by which that would be determined, similar to the manner of student loans. We've been, for example, looking at the minimum income standard and the minimum income guarantee and how that might work in practice as a tool to determine what the threshold would be. Obviously, that's still a work in development, but that's the kind of thinking that we have behind this, which would be more around the mechanism by which we determine what that threshold should be as opposed to prescribing what the threshold should be. Okay.
Really helpful. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Moving on to Team 5 now on appointees. I'm going to invite Paul in. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener. I just wondered if witnesses had any comment on the extent to which DWP appointees are already recognised within the Scottish Social Security system and, I suppose, the time it takes to be authorised under Scottish Social Security rules. John?
The existing provisions transferring people from disability living allowance and personal independence payment to the new disability payments do allow for recognition of DWP appointees. So this simply looks like it's mirroring that. For example, where somebody's got an appointee for Universal Credit and claims Scottish Child Payment, it looks like the intention is to allow a temporary treatment of someone as being appointed under Scottish legislation. So I think there is a slight concern with the drafting of it. As far as I can see, it doesn't prescribe that somebody must either be transferred into the mainstream appointment under the Act or the deemed appointment terminated. So it'll be interesting to see what the regulations say. And that's simply because the Scottish legislation allows somebody to raise concerns about an appointee, but there's nothing on the face of the bill that indicates there will be the ability to raise concerns if someone isn't transferred into the Scottish system. We don't have a lot of evidence on the time it takes to appoint people, but certainly of delays where there is no appointee. So one of the distinct features of the Scottish system is that if there is a parent with parental responsibilities for a child who lives with the child and is willing to act, there is no power to make an appointment. So one issue this can cause is where parents separate and they both still have parental rights, and one of them is acting for the child in relation to child disability payment. There's been long delays where the other parent is saying, I want to take over, this parent has left, and difficulties with interacting with Social Security Scotland there. So I'm afraid that's not an answer to the direct question, but it's the best we've got of a difficulty which is caused by changes of responsibility. So I think this is another area where very clear guidance publicly available so that advisers can support people to make their case and get a resolution to it would be helpful.
Okay, thanks very much. Before I move on to Team 6, I'm going to apologise to Diane because I believe that you wanted to come in and Bob's line of questions. Do you still want to come in, Diane?
No, that's fine. Thank you. I'm aware of sort of time pressure, so I'm happy for you to move on. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm now going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks very much, convener, and it's concerning part 6 of the bill providing information. And really to start with, and I'll maybe come to Mr Clancy, not obviously for a legal point of view, but anyway, do witnesses have any comment on the balance in these provisions between the right to social security on the one hand, but the principle that social security must ensure they get value for money and they're not paying out to people who shouldn't be entitled to benefits? Mr Clancy?
Indeed. Am I on? Sorry. Ah, yes, I am. Thanks very much indeed for that interesting question, Mr. Mason. Of course, we recognise that there is a balance between the country getting value for money in terms of payments made, but also we would like to highlight the other element of the social security principles, which is respect for the dignity of individuals who are at the heart of the social security system. And it is getting the right balance there that it certainly piqued the interest of our committee when looking at the provisions in the bill. When one takes a look at, I just get my copy of the bill in front of me, one takes a look at the new section 87B, obtaining information for audit, which is inserted by section 16 of the bill into the 2018 Act, you see there that Scottish ministers may request an individual who is entitled to assistance to provide, within such period as ministers specify, information about the individual's entitlement to assistance and the payment of assistance to the individual. And a request may only be made for the purposes of auditing the monetary value of error and fraud in the Scottish Social Security system and carrying out corrections of apparent errors and investigations into potential fraud. And I think we took a dim view of this linkage between an error and fraud, as stated in the bill. It certainly it strikes us as being a rather harsh approach, particularly when under subsection 5, that's 87B, subsection 5, Scottish ministers may, miscalling that, there we are, subsection 7, sorry, where Scottish ministers issue a decision to suspend assistance under subsection 6, which is what they can do if the person provides, or rather fails to provide, the requested information by the end of the period which the ministers have specified. And I think that that's probably the crux of the issue, is that for an error or a fraud investigation, if someone can't come up with the information which is being sought within the time limit allowed, the person can end up with their assistance being suspended. That seems a rather harsh penalty, even if there are ways to have that looked at later on in the succeeding sections of the bill. But it does seem strange to intermingle error and fraud in this way.
I mean, it almost seems the opposite of what we normally do in the courts, that you assume innocence until guilt's proven. It seems we're assuming guilt until innocence is proven. Is that fair?
I toyed with that idea myself, but of course, it's auditing the monetary value of error and fraud. So it's not about saying that an individual has committed fraud. It's about looking for evidence that there has been a fraud committed. And I think that those are two different things. Of course, on what basis is the audit being made? Now, I think the explanatory notes say that Scottish ministers thought that having a sanction such as suspension of assistance was important because there was no way to get this information voluntarily. I'm not well versed in extracting information from people, but I suspect there are agencies that can give the Scottish Minister's advice on getting information without going to the extent of imposing sanctions like this. There might be more softer ways of encouraging people to provide information on the error side. I accept that if a person has committed fraud, then they're not going to be happy about being investigated on the basis that there is a suspicion of fraud, and that's a different category of issue. But even that is not necessarily a derogation from the right to be or presumption of innocence. I think that that's quite clear in my mind that investigating a fraud is not undermining the presumption of innocence. It is simply an investigation. But error and fraud shouldn't be intermingled.
Okay, that's an extremely helpful answer. Thank you very much for that. Maybe I could move to Ms Connock now. I'm just going to widen this out, because we said, is the balance right between value for money on the one hand and human rights on the other? Also, this point that Mr Clancy raised about, if the system's entirely voluntary, well, nobody's going to tell you anything. And are there enough safeguards in place? So anything around that, Ms Connock?
Yeah, I think if it is voluntary, then yes, you may struggle to get enough of that information back. However, it is getting that balance, and I think it very much is around safeguarding as well, because my concern would certainly be that people who are really vulnerable aren't then sufficiently supported to participate when required to do so. So I think it is about ensuring that people are clear on what's been looked for, and there is contact, not just one-off contact or a letter. It's about looking at trying to obtain that information through on multiple occasions, through multiple channels. But again, I would be concerned about benefits being stopped as well for people, especially our most vulnerable claimants.
Do any of the other three want to come in? Mr Shaw, yes.
Yeah, absolutely agree with the points raised so far. I suppose the other thing here is that there doesn't need to be a suspicion of fraud here for people to end up losing their money. There does not need to be any indication that there is anything wrong with the person's award, which makes it vital that there are those safeguards for vulnerable individuals. I think if we're piling in on the principles, which it doesn't sit particularly well with, it's not being designed with the people of Scotland on the basis of evidence, and it's not putting the needs of those who require assistance first. I think, ways the safeguarding aspect could be improved could be if SCOS were scrutinising the regulations which are made under this power, which isn't currently in the bill. So there's not going to be any independent oversight of that. I think it's important that people can challenge the good reason provision. And it's also worth just looking at the drafting of subsection 4 of 87B, which, when we think about the care that's been taken around inclusive communication and making the system accessible to people, we've got a completely different style of drafting with, interview in person, which is going to feel to somebody like you're being interviewed under caution because someone suspects you of fraud. And I realise this could potentially partially be mitigated by the way in which it's implemented, but I guess coming back to the comment that we couldn't do this without making it compulsory and using the threat of suspension of benefits, I suppose I forget what the phrasing was, forgive me. It wouldn't be possible to get a statistically robust sample without doing this. So what approaches have been tried?
Yes.
What else are we looking at? We're going to have evidence of determinations and to what extent they're overturned at redetermination and appeal coming through the system anyway. And we are also dealing with disability benefits, the criteria for which are essentially very subjective. And the fact that two different decision makers could reach a different decision about the same person is not an indication of error in the legal sense or fraud. So I think there's a lot of issues with this, and particularly the lack of consultation before.
No, that's helpful. I mean, the way I use the word audit, certainly, there's a lot of ways of auditing a figure in accounts, for example, and it certainly wouldn't always include cross-examining somebody. Unless either of the other two want to come in, I'm happy to leave it there. Ms Young, I think, does.
Yeah, just add a few words. I think we're in danger of exaggerating a problem that is actually quite well and easily dealt with by the current law around fraud and official error. Just to put this in context, a recent Freedom of Information request answered in January of this year indicated that in 2023 there were 3,509 allegations of fraud. Now, in October 2023 alone, there were 10,145 ADP applications, which is just one Scottish benefit in 1 month. So that gives you a sense of the scale here. It's very tiny, and this critical point about the mix-up here between error and fraud, I think that simply has to be addressed in these provisions as they are at the moment. And I think the provisions also highlight the need for a safeguarding structure within Social Security Scotland, which doesn't currently exist in the same way as it does for certain other reserved benefits. And I think that's a concern that these provisions have highlighted the gap there and that it does need to be addressed. I mean, adult disability payment, for example, the claims process can have an enormous impact on people, and safeguarding mechanisms there are required. It's to keep people safe, ultimately. Similarly, with the use of adult disability payment, it is used for really effectively lifeline things, whether that's additional energy costs, whether it's travel that prevents social isolation, whether it's other forms of managing a condition. So again, it's a benefit that naturally needs some kind of a safeguarding process. In a situation like this, with the provisions that we have, if you turn that around into a Department of Work and Pensions scenario, they were forced to implement an entire system around advanced customer support leads to precisely to try and go in when someone was about to lose a benefit as a result of some of these provisions, in order to prevent, to be absolutely blunt, suicide and serious self-harm. Now, we do not want Social Security Scotland to end up in a situation where they are forced retrospectively to implement such a system because really horrific things have happened. So I just think
Would the counter to that not be that with the whole system with Social Security Scotland is built on different foundations? So you don't, you know, if it's meant to be more caring, does it have to be checked so much?
I absolutely appreciate that. But I think simply by the nature of the type of service it's delivering, you are going to be dealing with some of the most acutely vulnerable people within our society. Now, that's not to make any sweeping generalisations about who is accessing this benefit, absolutely not, but it is factually correct to say that it will incorporate some of the most vulnerable in our society. And if we are looking at these kinds of systems, it's very important that we have the right processes in place to capture people who are at risk.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
I believe Richard Gass would like to come in, and then Michael Clancy. Thank you.
Just discussing the kind of safeguards, and it was 87B, paragraph 5. They may make regulations, not shall make regulations, to create exemption categories, but I think that should be tighter. There should be a requirement to make regulations defining who would be exempt. And I would hope that an exempt category would be anybody who has been to an appeal tribunal, because to re-examine what's been in front of an appeal tribunal would be, well, it's been adjudicated on at a higher level.
Circumstances not have changed. Sorry, Mr. Gass, could circumstances not have changed after the appeal?
Well, I guess yes, there could be a change in circumstances. It depends on the time frame that we're auditing people in this respect, I guess. But if somebody has very recently been to an appeal tribunal, then I don't think it would be fair on someone who has had a difficult route to get their entitlement, then finds that they are subject to another process. I think folk would feel that they were being picked on, and I think we can probably avoid those and take an assumption that stuff that's recently been at a tribunal ought to be correct. And there's a right to withdraw for good reason, and I would hope that one of the good reasons would be adverse effect to health. So recognising that, yes, there's a duty to do the audit, but let's not, in the process of doing the audit, make vulnerable folk more vulnerable and lose their entitlement.
OK, that's helpful as well. Mr. Glancy, did you want a final word?
Yes, if I may, it would have been remiss of me not to point out to the committee the existence of the Code of Practice for Investigations by Social Security Scotland, which tells us in Chapter 3 what to expect if you are being investigated. And one of the things you have to expect is to be interviewed under caution. This is in a fraud investigation. Now, looking closely at Section 87B, I don't think there is a reference there to any kind of caution in the highlighted subsection, which has already been spoken about, subsection 4, requiring the interview in person, telephone call, blah, blah, blah. But there's nothing there about the statement of rights that someone should expect to have, because we don't want to impugn, and I'm sure that Scottish ministers have no intention of impugning the presumption of innocence at all. So people ought to be put on their guard. And to a certain extent, that's the recognition that Scottish ministers are treading cautiously here is to draw attention to 87D and 87E, which relate to, respectively, a right to support for response to request and a right of a right to advocacy. And now, I think it's important that we understand these things are easy to say on a statute, but less easy to make sure in terms of practical experience of people on the ground.
Yeah, that's helpful. I think we'll explore that further in future. Thanks, Convener.
OK, thanks very much. I'm very conscious of time now, and I'm moving on to Part 7 of the bill. And do witnesses agree with the principle of compensation recovery? And is it consistent with the social security principles? So I'm going to ask Diane and Richard. So, Diane, would you like to come in on that? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I think, I mean, there is a responsibility to manage public funds, and certainly that's the way sort of things operate within the DWP benefits at the moment. I think it does need to be clearly explained to claimants, though, by solicitors and their advocates, because certainly, you know, people could, you know, be expecting the money and have, you know, spent that or whatever that they're getting through, not realising that that money has to be, you know, paid back at that stage. So I definitely think there could be that, you know, clear expectation that you know, it's clearly explained. But certainly I do agree that I think within the principles of social security, it should need to be paid back.
OK, Diane, thanks very much. Richard, would you like to come in?
Yes, quickly, yes. We'd agree that there should be some compensation recovery, and that that should be something that's done at the point of settlement, so that the person's lawyer who's seeking the compensation on behalf of the appellant, or the claimant rather, that there's an amount built in to the award on the basis that that will be recovered to Social Security Scotland, and that any ongoing benefits are not affected. It's a kind of it's a one-off thing that happens, almost invisible to the claimant. And on that basis, it would replicate what DWP do, and that would be reasonable.
Okay, thanks, Richard. Now moving on to Part 8 of the bill, what further regulations should be added to SCOSI's remit, and why? And I'm going to pose that question to John. Thank you.
We think, basically, in principle, anything that affects an individual's rights or the processes of making decisions should be within SCOSA's remit. And on the rights point, that would include the information for audit provisions. I suppose compensation recovery is a slightly different case, given it doesn't look like it would affect the individual, but essentially in the reserve system that is so scrutinised by the Social Security Advisory Committee, so we're not sure what the argument would be for not including regulations about compensation recovery. So yeah, basically should be a very good reason for it not to be, and nothing to do with an individual's rights or the processes involved in decision making should be excluded.
Okay, now moving on to part, well, it's more theme 9 in terms of the actual principles of social security. I'm now going to invite Katie Clark in. Thank you.
Thank you. And we've already had some reference in relation to the principles regarding compensation recovery, but there have been a number of examples given of aspects of these proposals which don't seem to adhere to the statutory principles and seem to simply mirror the approach taken by the Department of Work and Pensions. So maybe could I ask John Shaw in the first instance, to what extent does he think the bill as a whole aligns with the social security principles?
I think that's a difficult question. I think there's definite potential for the changing of the basis for Scottish child payment to contribute to reducing equality and promoting, reducing poverty and promoting equality. Mm-hmm. But as discussed, that depends on how many of my laundry lists of asks are actually implemented in the regulations themselves. I think we've covered very well the specific sections which appear to counter some of the other principles in the way in which they've been consulted on and implemented. So I think it is hard to come to a view on the bill as a whole. I think you'd probably say it's a mixed bag, and some sections are undoubtedly positive whilst others raise concern.
So it's fair to say that the individuals getting more money is clearly an improvement, but do you think, you know, if we put that to one side, because that clearly is a massive step forward, but in terms of the client experience and the way that the process is, do you think that the bill improves the client experience for claimants compared with previous ways that these matters have been dealt with?
I think on some of the technical ones it definitely does. So Section 4 and Section 6, uncomplicatedly improvements to the system. I'm slightly cheekily conscious that something a little bit technical I should have said about Section 7, which was something that we called for, if the convener will indulge me with 30 seconds. We think that the drafting could be improved in order to improve the client experience, and in particular the requirement that there is an error before an appeal can be lapsed, and that's using the word error in the legal sense. And what we see is actually lots of decisions are changed just because two decision makers can come to a different view on the facts. So by introducing a requirement for an error, what you're doing is you're creating a barrier to the decision maker, and then they will put that to the individual and say, well, can you explain to me, you know, why is it in error? And given we're using this in a legal sense, it's going to be difficult. And the other thing which will obviously be detrimental to client experience is, even once that appeal has ended, if somebody decides that they want to try and get mount a further challenge, having taken advice, they'll need to go back to the redetermination stage before they can get back to appeal. And we've now seen a determination looked at 3 times, and we're suggesting a 4th redetermination before you can get back to appeal again. So things like that could improve the client experience, but I certainly think that some of the technical changes will be uncontroversially positive for individuals.
Thank you for that, and we'll no doubt look at that carefully later. But are there any other provisions that haven't been mentioned up to now that any of the witnesses would want to flag up as making the experience worse? Any aspects that you think the committee need to look at in terms of improving the legislation? Maybe, I don't know if any of the other witnesses have indicated they want to come in. Erica Young?
Richard, I believe, would like to come in. Thanks, Katie.
Perhaps one area that's missing from the bill is a kind of review of the short-term assistance, and this is something I'm sure CPAG have already highlighted to Social Security Scotland and maybe even to the committee, and that's where someone claims short-term assistance, while pending an appeal, and it's to their detriment because short-term assistance doesn't count as a qualifying benefit for the premiums that they'd get on their DWP benefits. So they win their appeal, but they don't get the backdated DWP money. And the easiest correction there would be that what happens is the short-term assistance is recovered and then replaced by the benefit that was under the subject of the appeal. John might want to say more on that.
I think Richard summarised the issue very well. We're, to be perfectly honest, we're struggling to be clear what the officials think the situation is with short-term assistance. I mean, it is clear that it's not a qualifying benefit for either devolved or reserved entitlements in terms of the law. We could certainly write to the committee with more detail
Thank
on
you.
That if you wanted.
Thank you. I don't know if any other witness has indicated they want to come in.
No, there's... No, I believe Richard already came in, sorry. I think Michael Glancy would like to come in on that. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. So I was wondering about that balancing act which needs to be carried out in terms of compliance with the social security principles and all that we've talked about in this bill already. Of course, one feature of the social security principles is the declaration that social security is in itself a human right and essential to the realisation of other human rights. And as we're going to be entering an epoch in Scotland soon, where human rights are pushed higher and higher up the agenda, with the prospect of a Scottish Human Rights Bill coming into the Parliament later this year. I think it's important that we get this right, no pun intended, because it's going to be something which will become far more visible in terms of the use of legislation, use of the Social Security Act, etc. And I think it's important to remind ourselves of what is involved in this connection between social security and human rights. And the UN Human Rights High Commissioner has set out the key elements about availability, adequacy, affordability and accessibility. And if the committee is going to use that as a test for the extent to which this bill complies with that idea of social security as a human right, then that could be a route forward for you.
Thank you.
Okay, that's very helpful. I don't know if Jeremy wanted to come in. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of technical questions, and maybe start with you, Mr. Clancy. Just unfortunately, due to timing, the delegated powers committee haven't looked fully at the delegated powers within this bill, but they are quite far-reaching and quite wide. And I'm just wondering, from a legal perspective, are you satisfied that the balance is about right in regard to the powers that have been delegated to Scottish Government, or is that something we should take a bit more evidence on?
It's an interesting question you raise. I have not myself specifically looked at the delegated powers provisions with that level of scrutiny, but what I can do is I can undertake that we'll remit that to our Administrative Justice Subcommittee and see if we can write to the committee in the not-too-distant future. For personal reasons, I won't be particularly involved in that, but I'm sure that the committee will be able to do that very successfully soon.
I'm grateful. Thank you for that. The second issue is one of the issues that we debated long and hard when the original Act was going through was the Charter. And I'm just wondering, in regard to how it has worked in practice, had the Charter made any significant difference to the client's experience? And one of the other things we debated was whether it should have any legal basis, the Charter. And I'm just wondering, 4 or 5 years on from the Act being passed, should it have a legal status, or is it sitting in about the right place? I appreciate it's slightly left field, so if you want to take it away and write back to the committee, I'm happy if you don't have a view on that today.
That's a question addressed to me, yes.
To anyone, Mr. Clancy, I'm open it wide.
Very good. Right. OK, excellent. I'll leave it to other people to reply.
Great answer. Thanks very much, Michael. OK, I believe Marie would like to come in and then we'll conclude our business. Thank you.
Thanks. I just wanted to go back to Richard Gass. I mean, you seem to want to say something earlier on about the first-tier tribunals and how they're operating in relation to the Scottish benefits. I believe you were cut off, but if not, I mean, come in quite briefly on that, if you don't mind.
Yes, thank you. I thought that I'd kind of missed my slot on that. But we do have some practical problems with the Scottish first-tier tribunal, or not so much the tribunal itself, but getting to the first-tier tribunal, and that is an insistence from Social Security Scotland that our mandatory reconsideration, redetermination rather, is done on the correct form, and that an appeal is done on the correct form. And we have standard letters that we use in these situations, which has our contact name, our details. It lays out a lot of stuff, and it speeds up the whole process. But what we're finding is that the MR letters that we send in are being returned, and the requirement for it to be on a specific form, and that the appeal letters are not being actioned. And the legislation, as far as I can make out, doesn't require them to be on prescribed forms. So that was really in relation to a question in the Spice paper about what changes could be made that didn't require legislative change. And there's one that allow folk to voice their reconsideration or their appeal in the form they prefer.
Thank you.
That is very helpful, and apologies, Richard, for earlier. We missed that question off, so apologies for that. So that concludes this evidence session, and I know it's been particularly long, so thank you to all our witnesses, and you've given us a really, really useful content to support the scrutiny of the bill as well, so thanks again. And next week we will continue to take evidence on the bill with a panel focusing on concerns of specific groups of potentially vulnerable clients who would need support to actually navigate around the system. So that concludes our public business, and we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you.